Okay, so good afternoon everyone. Today I'm going to take the third class of the online HBI course on emerging trend in biophysics. So my part of the course is multi-scale modeling and simulations of biological system. So far we have tried to understand the theory behind the classical molecular dynamic simulation. And then in the last class, we also saw how to set up a molecular dynamic simulation and also studied some advanced simulation technique for free energy calculation. As you have already understand that the calculation of free energy difference is a very important task in molecular modeling calculation, and there are specialized technique like what we discussed, umbrella sampling, free energy perturbation, and thermodynamic integration. So having learned this technique, that is the classical MD simulation, now we will see some system and try to understand whether we can simulate this system or not. So this is, I have already shown you in the last class, that is the molecular machine in our body that produces the ATP, that is the energy currency of our cell. So here you see the swivelling motion of the ATP synthesis. So how do we simulate or how do we study this kind of a system? You can definitely simulate any globular protein, I mean not involving much complexity, using the classical MD simulation. You can see the structural fluctuation through the RMSD calculation or RMSF calculation. And also you can calculate some thermodynamic properties, dynamical properties from classical MD simulation. But this molecular machine is a very complex system. I mean, it involves physical motion as well as chemical phenomena. I mean, so how do we simulate this kind of a complicated system? So next, we will see this system. So this is an example of a system where light falls on the biological system and there is some transformation like isomerization of a chemical entities happening. So how do we study the ultra-fast photodynamics of biological system? I mean, you already know the Wiesen process that happened in our body. I mean, when light falls on the, you know, rhodopsin actually, and the afterwards changes. And so these processes, can you study using molecular modeling and simulation? And this is a very well-known example of photosystem two that is involved in photosynthesis that capture light from the sun and then, I mean, produces dioxygen and also form glucose. So this is a very complex system. So how do we study this kind of a complex system? And here you know that is the DNA. So you see that these are the molecular orbitals. So now in classical MD simulation, what we have learned so far, there is no such picture available. I mean, it's just the atom that constitute the biological system. You can see the motion of those atoms or nothing else, and you see the dynamics as well, I mean the fluctuation, so all these things. But here you can see in the inside interior of the DNA the molecular orbital picture of the underlying interaction. So how do we get this system? So far I'm showing you this system because these are examples or representative of very complex biological system, and classical MD simulation is not enough to understand or investigate this kind of a biological system. So we have to move to advanced simulation technique. That is the that's what we are going to learn today. So we are going to learn some of the multi-scale simulation method. But before we go further, what we assume in the classical MD simulation is that following thing, that the macromolecules are described as a collection of balls connected by spring, while interacting through non-nearest neighbor through charges, Coulomb interaction, and short-range repulsion. This is I am showing so that I mean we are very much aware of the approximation that is involved in classical MD simulation, because next I will go to some other description of atoms and molecules, so that will be easier to differentiate between these two branch of physics. And the general strategy was that you have to give supply parameters. I mean, you have to first define, I mean, construct a topology file, and then you have to supply parameters to be enabled for a molecule to be, I mean, undergo a molecular dynamic simulation. Now, we have already seen this also, that the breaking or making of chemical bonds with electron reorganization cannot be tackled by this MD simulation. So we came to know about a technique that is the hybrid quantum mechanics molecular mechanics method. Now, what are the challenges to simulate biochemical reaction? Now, in our body, there are so many chemical reactions are happening helped by various kind of enzymes and other system. So classical MD simulation are not sufficient. You have seen the initial few systems that are very complex, and classical MD simulation would not be sufficient to study those systems, because you need electronic quantum effects to describe those kind of interaction that is there in those systems. And if you want to simulate the quantum mechanical simulation of that kind of a large system, so that is not also feasible, because no computer nowadays, I mean, can simulate such a big system quantum mechanically. So we have a hybrid approach, that is quantum mechanics, molecular mechanics, which includes the electronic quantum mechanical effects in simulations of large system. So what we are doing, we have already seen this molecular mechanics part. Now you are going to see the quantum mechanics part, so that we can combine the best of both the world, that is the classical world, that's the molecular mechanics part, and then the best from the quantum world. And then we can see actually how can we combine this technique and simulate or investigate such complicated system. Now this is are a general category of multi-scale methods, which combine different levels of theory and resolution. And these are very vital for studying any complex biological system. So what these multi-scale methods can do? You see, many biological processes involve the transport of electrons and protons, for example, in photosynthesis, and respiration via the complex respiratory complex one, if you see. And here is the schematic representation of this photosynthesis. So you see, this is a very complex system, and ATP synthesis already you have seen quite a few times since I have represented this as an example for a complex chemical or biological system. So you see, there are oxygen evolving complex, and there are so many protons and electrons are transferred from this place to that place. So these are very complicated biological system. Not only the protein environment, that is the amino acid environment, lipid environment are involved, but also there are transport of electrons and protons. So multi-scale methods are appropriate method that can study this kind of a system, because as you have seen that this proton and electron transport need quantum mechanical treatment. Now, there are various multi-scale methods available. These I will come in a little more detail in the next slides. That is the empirical valence bond method, that is basically a semi-empirical QMM method. then the ab initio QMM free energy calculation, and then we will come to the Coarse-Grain method. Now, definitely these methods are very specified. So the choice of methods depends on the questions you want to ask. So what quantum mechanics is all about? In theory, quantum mechanics provides a very accurate description of the system, and this is ab initio in nature. That means you don't need to supply or you don't need to get parameters to run a quantum mechanical simulation. But unfortunately, according to the theoretical formulation of this thing, this is computationally expensive. That means you need more computer, high performance computing system to do any quantum mechanical system of any big system. And also it is restricted to relatively small system. So quantum mechanical simulation of the entire protein is not feasible, as you have already seen that this is a computationally expensive. Now, compared to the quantum mechanics, what is molecular mechanics is all about? In molecular mechanics, there is no electronic degrees of freedom. You do not see any electron concept of electron there in molecular mechanics. And bond angles and dihedrals are described by force field terms. But good thing is that molecular mechanics can be applied to very large system, because this is the approximation that is used in classical ND simulation to understand a large biological system. But the drawback of this molecular mechanical force field is that it cannot describe bond breaking and making processes. So here is the force field term. This you have already seen, I think, many times. This is the bond angle term, this is the angle term, this is the torsion angle term, and the non-bonded interaction, that is the van der Waals and the electrostatic interaction. So this is basically the molecular mechanic force field term that is used in the classical MD simulation. And there is no bond breaking or bond forming term is involved is there. I mean, the bond, the approximation suggests that the bonds can at maximum, it can stretch, it can contract like that. So it will just vibrate. So that happens. So there is no bond breaking or making processes that is described in this molecular mechanical force field. Now coming to the quantum mechanical description of atoms, I was repeating the classical mechanical picture, the molecular mechanical picture of the atom that is used in MD simulation, because now we will contrast that with this quantum mechanical description of atoms. Now, atomic or subatomic particles have wave particle duality. So that is quite and very interesting thing, that it is neither wave, it is neither particle, it can be a both wave. So, earlier we have a picture, classical picture that is used in MD simulation is that the atoms are represented as a balls with partial atomic charges, and then they are connected by spring. But here you see that they have wave particle duality, and it needs special branch of physics to describe them. And here came the birth of quantum mechanics. This is the branch of physics that will deal with this quantum particle. And you see, I have already shown that a quantum particle is described by a wave packet. This is how it is. Here is that picture. So this is how a quantum mechanical particle is described. Now you contrast these to the classical picture. There we just represented the atom or whatever by just a point charges, nothing else. Now we are coming to the real physical nature of the particle, atomic or subatomic particle. Now, according to the postulates of quantum mechanics, the state of any quantum mechanical system is represented by wave function. Now, what is this wave function? This wave function is a function that will contain all the information about that quantum mechanical particle. And how do we get all those properties from the wave function? So there are certain quantum mechanical postulate. I'm not going into detail into that postulate because that we need a separate class. So according to these postulates, you will get all the mathematical relation or equation that will be required to derive properties or, you know, describe any system, quantum mechanical system, by this wave function. So this is the main equation in quantum mechanics. In classical MD simulation, the main equation was Newton's equation of motion. That is force equal to mass into acceleration. That was used to generate the trajectory using the molecular mechanical force field. Now we are having this main time-dependent Schrodinger equation. That is the main equation in quantum mechanics. And here this I h cross dou by dou t psi depends on xt equal to h cap psi xt. So h is the Hamiltonian operator. Here it should be cap actually. That is the operator. So operators are very important in quantum mechanics because those are the thing that will operate on a function and extract the relevant property. So here is the Hamiltonian operator, a hat should be there. So this corresponds to the total energy of the system. And psi, as you already know, represent the wave function. So this is the basic equation, that is the Schrodinger equation of quantum mechanics. Now we can derive the time-independent Schrodinger equation from this equation, that is h psi equal to e psi. So if you ask the question that how can you obtain psi, then psi should be the answer is psi should be a function that should satisfy this equation. Then psi will be an acceptable wave function for the system of interest. So now we know two main equations. One is the Newton's equation of motion that was involved in classical MD simulation. Now we are reading about the main equation of quantum mechanics, that is Schrodinger equation, that is h psi equal to e psi. Now having we have got the flavor of quantum mechanics in very basic level, because you know, this is a very detailed topic. And it needs several classes to describe all the properties and derivation, everything. But the basic thing about quantum mechanics is that the atoms or the subatomic particle are represented by a wave function that is, I mean, appropriate to describe its wave particle duality. Now, here I have, in this slide, I have shown you the levels of biological organization. You see that atom, that is the quantum mechanical thing, and how the other things are coming from there, from atom to molecule, then the molecule to macromolecule, then to organelle, and then to cell, to tissue, to organ, and then to a human being. So quantum mechanics is the one of the fundamental science that will describe the properties at this atomistic level. Now we are trying to study, you know, this large biological system, and those are very complex in nature and needs quantum mechanics also as part of this their investigation. So coming to quantum mechanical methods, there are various kind of quantum mechanical methods that will utilize the principle of quantum mechanics. So these are very detailed method, but I'm just giving you the basic features what are the some names of some quantum electronic structure method. These are called electronic structure method. So there are semi-empirical method. So they explicitly considers only the valence electron of the system. The core electrons are subsumed into the nuclear one. So the problem or the difficult part of quantum mechanics is that you need to solve certain equations, and these equations involve calculations of integral of various several large number of integrals, and that will be very time taking and computationally demanding. So the semi-empirical methods try to avoid that all calculation of the all integral. So what it only assume, it only deal with the valence electron of the system. The core electrons are subsumed, I mean approximated some other way, not explicitly. So there are various semi-empirical methods like this MNDO, AM1, PM3. There are several others. We will see in the QMM method the implication of the importance of the semi-empirical method. Why? I mean, though these are approximate quantum chemical method, but they are still important for describing large biological system. And then there are the ab initio method. In ab initio calculation, hello, can you hear me? Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
Okay. Then fine. Okay. So now, regarding the ab initio method, in ab initio calculation, all elements of the Fock matrix are calculated. So the greatest time spent on performing ab initio Hartree-Fock SF calculation in the calculation of the integrals, and it takes time and as well as computational resources. Now these are ab initio method, means that you don't have to supply any parameters or make any approximation, I mean in principle, for this kind of a method. So there are these ab initio method. This HFT is Hartree-Fock, this is MP2, this is a correlated method, and this there is the couple cluster method. Now these are very high level ab initio method. The good thing about ab initio method that you don't need to give any parameter or approximate crudely to perform any quantum mechanical calculation. And then there are another popular, many of you may already have heard about this DFT method, that is the density functional theory method. The central idea is that there is a relationship between the total electronic energy and the overall electronic density, and that the ground state energy and other properties of a system were uniquely defined by the electron density. So these are very basic description of the quantum chemical methods, that is the semi-empirical method, ab initio method, density functional method. Now each method warrants a separate discussion. So I will suggest those who are interested to go to any quantum mechanical textbook or the molecular modeling book by Andrew Leach to read more and go into more details to understand this method. So now we are coming to the QMM simulation part. Now this is the picture I have taken from it, that Nobel lecture by Michael Levitt, Quantum Mechanics of Enzymatic Reaction, that was performed in 1976. So now we are going to learn what are the basic assumption or the theoretical framework behind this hybrid QMM method. So How do we treat the system in a QMM setup? The entire system is divided into two subsystems. One is the quantum mechanical part, and another is the molecular mechanical part. And then there is the boundary region. So to get a real example, this is the salicylate dioxygenase enzyme. So now you see that here the chemistry, the chemical reaction is happening in this circle. So this region is described by quantum mechanical method, and the rest of the system is described by the molecular mechanical method. So this is how we divide a system to do hybrid QMM simulation. This is the basic picture that you divide the system into two parts. One is the quantum mechanical part, that is the smallest part. You should divide it so as to you don't need to treat large number of atoms by quantum mechanics, because it will be computationally very demanding. Now, how do we get the energy expression in QMM? You already know about the energy expression in classical MD simulation. In classical MD simulation, we use the molecular mechanical force field, and you already saw the force field terms. Now, here is the energy expression for QMM. Total energy is given by one is the EQM plus EMM plus EQMM part. And here is the very schematic representation of the system, biological system. This part is treated by quantum mechanics, and this part is treated by molecular mechanics. Now, what is the energy expression implies is that as follows. EQM is the quantum mechanical energy of the small part of that system. And you can use semi-empirical DFT ab initio electronic structure method to get the quantum mechanical energy. And EMM is the energy from the molecular mechanical force field term. But the main challenge in QMM method is that integrating the two different methods. You see that we are using two different kind of method. One is quantum mechanics that we have already read about. That's quite an different branch of physics dealing with the atomic and subatomic particle. And then there are the simpler molecular mechanical force field. So the main challenge in QMM method is to treat this boundary, that is the interface between the QM and MM. So how do we treat that thing? Next, we will come to that. So we have various scheme actually to treat this boundary region QMM. So here is the subtractive QMM scheme, where what we do, first we perform MM calculation of the entire protein or biological system. Then we perform QM calculation on the inner system one. And then we perform MM calculation on the inner system. This should be two. It is not one. This should be two, because we divided the system into QM part, that is one, that is I, and then the MM part is represented by two. So this is very plain actually. It means that the QM part is not influenced by the molecular mechanical point charges. I mean, they are doing calculation independently. Next, coming to the additive QMM scheme, what we do here, this is the expression. And what we do here, we perform a MM calculation on the outer subsystem, that is two, and QM calculation on the inner subsystem one. Now the coupling term is handled very delicately. I mean, it accounts for the interaction between the two subsystems, that is the QM part and the MM part. And majority of the present QMM methods are of the additive type, because it describes the system more realistically. So how do we now treat the boundary region, that is the coupling term, that is the QMM boundary region. The exact form of the coupling term defines a specific QMM method. There will be many QMM method, but based on the handling of the coupling term, that is the QMM boundary region, that QMM method will be specified as a particular one. So here at the expression, the QMM boundary region is treated like in accordance with the force field term. If you see that the boundary region also have a bond term, it also has the van der Waals term as well as the electrostatic term. Now in the additive QMM scheme, how do we calculate these forces, the interaction between the these two subsystems? There are various kind of technique or approaches to treat this additive QMM scheme. One is the mechanical embedding. So the mechanical embedding is that the QMM electrostatic interaction is treated in the same level as the MM electrostatic. So that is not quite realistic, because QMM dealing with a very sophisticated nature of the system, and MM is a rather more simpler approximation of the atom. So the mechanical embedding treat the electrostatic interaction in this way. The interesting thing about that there are two more embedding, that is a electrostatic embedding, and that is more realistic in nature. So what is that electrostatic embedding? The QM calculation is performed in the presence of MM charge model. So this is the Hamiltonian representation. So what it means basically is the following thing. You are dividing your biological system in two parts. One is the smaller QM part, the other is the larger molecular mechanical part. Now, when the QM calculation, that is the only the quantum mechanical calculation is going on, there will be variance of charges on the quantum mechanical atoms, means this small region. And this molecular mechanical charge, point charges are fixed. So they should be able to, these charges in the two regions, quantum mechanical region and the molecular mechanical region, should be able to interact with one another. That means the QM charges should be influenced by the molecular mechanical point charges. So in the electrostatic embedding, we take care of that approximation, that the MM charges, that the molecular mechanical point charges influence the QM region. And that's how the calculation is goes on. And then there is that polarized embedding. So that is another more very realistic approach, but it will be computationally more expensive, because in the earlier approach, electrostatic scheme, I have told you that the QM charges are influenced by the molecular mechanical charges. But in the polarized embedding, that is this one, the MM charges should be also influenced by the QM charges. And the more influence of one region into another you try to include, the more computationally demanding it would be. In many cases, you will just apply the electrostatic embedding, allowing the QM charges to be influenced by the MM charges. That's enough, actually. And polarized embedding will be a little more computationally demanding. So you can get a good result or reliable result by applying the electrostatic embedding scheme. And another thing that needs to be taken care in the QMM approach, that is the boundary, the treatment of the QMM boundary region. Suppose you are cutting the region through a covalent bond. Many times it will happen that you are taking a very small part of your biological system and then you need to cut through a covalent bond. So how do you treat that cutting of a covalent bond? How do you treat covalent bonds cut by the QMM boundary? So there are various approaches. So I will describe here, this is another successful approach, that is the link atom approach. So it introduces an additional atomic center L, usually a hydrogen atom that is not part of the real system. The link atom is covalently bound to Q1 and saturates its free valency. That means if you cut a covalent bond, so that those would be dangling valency. So that those should be satisfied. Otherwise, the system, simulation of the system will not be realistic. So that's why the link atom approach are there to make a very realistic modeling of the QMM boundary region, so that overestimation of this electrostatic interaction does not happen. And if it happens, it will introduce error in the calculation. So far, we have seen the theoretical basis of QMM simulation and the major challenge involved in the QMM simulation is the interfacing part. That is, how do you interface the QM region with the MM region? And also, we have seen that how you treat the boundary region, that is the link atom approach, and there are other approaches also. So based on your requirement, you can choose one. So here are the various QMM method. That is, the one is the empirical valence bond method, that is EVB. So it was developed by Professor Arya Warshall. And this is basically a semi-empirical QMM method. And why this is important, we will see in the next slide. And then there are QMM free energy calculation. It utilizes a paradynamics approach to get a free energy surface of the for the system. So the interesting thing is to note from all this discussion is that the QMM calculation need to be combined with free energy perturbation and umbrella sampling method. Now, because these methods, as we have studied earlier, are enhanced sampling method. It will help you to get more exposure to your system. That means the system can visit many regions in the conformational space. And the more region it samples or it visits, the more accurate your thermodynamic data will be. So QMM setup, once you set the potential or the QMM energy term expression, then you have to do a QMM MD. That is it is referred by the QMM MD simulation. So you need to allow the sampling to happen with the QMM, but unfortunately it is very computationally demanding. First thing is the calculation of the QM part. It is a small part containing maybe 100 or 200 atoms at max. So it will be computationally very demanding. And then furthermore, you have to take care of the sampling issue. That is also another computationally demanding part. So that's why semi-empirical QMM method, which is a relatively simpler QM method compared to the ab initio QM method. As we have seen the basic features of this semi-empirical QM method, ab initio QM method. But in the semi-empirical QM method, it treats only the valence electron. So it approximates the interaction of the other electrons it only treat explicit the valence electron, and the other electrons are subsumed into the nuclear one. So that's how it reduces the calculation cost. That means you will need less computational, comparatively less computational power to perform SME empirical QMM MD simulation. So having seen all these things, we will go to the application of the QMM method. So these methods are very useful. Here I'm presenting only one example. I mean, it can be applied to various kind of problem, as I have already shown you the initial complicated system. Suppose you want to know the mechanism of an enzymatic catalysis. So you want to know what are the intermediates, what are the transitions, all these things. So this is the system we will take as an example, that is the salicylate dioxygenase. So that small part here in circle is treated by the QM method. That is the, here the bond breaking and bond making is happening in this circle here. So it is treated by the quantum mechanical part, and the rest of the system, including the solvent, is treated at the molecular mechanics level. So the question we have asked is that how is O2 activated in this enzyme? This is an enzyme, basically it captures dioxygen from air and then break the oxygen-oxygen bond and then incorporate the two oxygen atom into a substrate, that is the salicylate. So we want to understand actually how all this chemical reaction, that is the bond breaking and bond making, is happening. So this is the part of the system you see. I mean, here is the region that is described quantum mechanically, and the oxygen is entering here. So our question, this is a metallo enzyme. So our question is that this is the iron actually represented by this ball symbol, and this is the oxygen already attached. You see that it takes an particular orientation. This is an end on orientation of the dioxygen bounded to the iron oxygen atom. So we want to understand the how is the iron oxygen bonding, because that is important to understand the versatile O2 chemistry. Now, since this is a part of the bond breaking and bond making process, one needs to apply QMM method to study this kind of enzymatic system. So in what way this QMM method is useful? The mechanism of this enzymatic system is already suggested by the experimentalists. You see that based on mutational studies. So here is the full mechanistic pathway. Just you can concentrate on the circle part, because that is the part which cannot be explained by the experimental result itself. And here comes the importance of the QMM method, that you can apply this QMM method to investigate or to explain the whole reaction pathway of an enzymatic system. And when we perform the QMM simulation of the system, what we found that this iron atom here, it activates the oxygen as well as the substrate synergistically. So it's a synergistic activation of the substrate and the dioxygen. So that is quite unusual in nature, because generally what happens, first the metal atom activates the oxygen, and then the following reaction happen. But here actually the activation happens synergistically, and then the further chemical reactions happen. So we get this picture. I mean, I'm giving you only the results actually. No, you know, how did you set up the QMM system, and how did you analyze all these things? I'm not going into detail. And from QMM calculation, what you get, you can get this molecular orbital picture you see here. So that is another important part of this QMM method. You can go to very fine level. In the initial slide, I have shown you a DNA, that is, you know, the interaction in the inside of the DNA, and those are represented by molecular orbital. So if you want to get this molecular orbital picture, I mean, to explain some experimental result for your system, you need to do a QMM calculation. And this is the whole pathway that is that can explain the experimental result coherently from the QMM simulation. So I'm just showing you that these are the application that QMM method can give you. I mean, it helps to unravel the reaction mechanistic pathway of the enzymatic system. So these are the other application of the QMM. You can see that you can apply for drug design. You can apply to design enzyme, and also you can study drug metabolism, and also you can study the principle of catalysis. I mean, what is the origin of their catalytic power? So this all thing I have just represented only one system, and just to show you that how the reaction mechanism of an enzymatic system can be investigated. But there are other applications of the QMM because it is a multi-scale method. As you have already seen, that the QMM method can treat the electron quantum mechanically. So wherever this electron transport or electron movement or this kind of situation arises, I mean, this QMM method will be particularly useful to understand that kind of a system. Now coming to another multi-scale method, that is the coarse grain method. Now, what is this method is about? I mean, this is a simplified model and is created by replacing the explicit side chain of each residue by an effective unified atom and an additional dummy atom. So what you basically do here is that suppose there are side chains of your amino acid. So you do not represent the side chain in an atomistic description. What you do, you just assume that the side chain is represented by a single atom, that is called an unified atom, so that the degrees of freedom will be significantly reduced, and it will allow you to perform an MD simulation with a very large time scale, as well as, you know, you can also explore the free energy surface quite effectively. Now the unified atoms are placed at the center of mass of the corresponding side chains. I mean, this is how we are treating, because you are reducing, you are approximating the side chain of your amino acid or a part of your biological system by a unified atom. And so how do you treat that unified atom? So the unified atoms are placed at the center of mass of the corresponding side chains, and the dummy atoms are placed along the corresponding CC vectors and serve as tools for rotational transformation in the process of moving between the simplified and explicit model. The backbone atoms of each residue are treated explicitly, and the interactions between main chain atoms are identical to those used in the explicit model. So this is called coarse grain method. I mean, as we will see in the next slide, this method will be helpful to study very large system, biological system, because you can reduce the degrees of freedom by using this method, and it will allow you to run longer simulation for your biological system. So how is the potential energy term of this coarse grain method? This is these are the contribution in the coarse grain method. U main is the potential energy for the main chain. That is the, if you suppose you take the C alpha atoms of your proteins or biological system, then that this term, this U main correspond to the potential energy for the main chain. And then there are the this term U main side. So this is this describe the interaction between effective side chain and the main chain atom. Why effective side chain? Because as I have told you, the cross grain method implies that the side chain, the whole side chain will be represented by a single atom, a unified atom. So that's why it is called an effective side chain, not an exact side chain. So this term describe interaction between effective side chain and main chain atoms. And then there are, you know, side chain interactions, interaction between the side chains. And then there are this term U-cell solvation. It accounts for the change in the solvation energy of each of these group upon moving from water to its protein site. So this simplified model, that is that this coarse grain model, can be used to determine the free energy of the protein as a function of any given set of coordinates. I mean, this is what you are doing. You are trying to make your system, large system, a more simple one, so that, I mean, the degrees of freedom, the terms that you need to calculate or compute using various method is reduced significantly. And as a result, the computational resource or the computational demand also is reduced significantly. Now, this is the past coarse grain simulation of folding that was performed by this Aria Warshin and Michael Levitt in the 1975. They used, if you see that in the left hand side, these are the peptide chain, part of the peptide chain, alanine, valine, glycine. And in the right hand side, this is the representation. See that the backbone atoms, that the C alpha atoms are represented exactly. Yeah, this one. But you see that the side chain, that is, suppose this is the methyl group, and that is represented by a single unified atom. So that is mean coarse grain. You are representing this methyl group by a single unified atom. And this is why that is called a reduced model, because you are reducing the degrees of freedom of the system. And they perform the protein folding simulation of a protein by using this method, because it will allow you to run longer simulation. And since protein folding phenomena takes long time scale, so it will be coarse grain method will be effective in investigating problem like this. Now coming to the application part, we will see how coarse grain method can be used. So this is a adenylate kinase enzyme, and this is a very important enzyme. And what it does, you see that this is the open conformation and this is the closed conformation, and here are the two substrate. So they undergo chemical reaction, but when this enzyme undergoes a conformational transition from open to closed conformation, and then the chemical reaction happens. So the question was whether this opening closing of this enzyme or the conformational dynamics has any influence on the chemical reaction of the enzyme or not. So this is that, I mean, we use the transition state theory to calculate the rate constant. But if you use normal classical MD simulation to observe this conformational transition, you will not be able to visualize this conformational transition, because in the normal time scale, I mean, that is allowed for classical MD simulation, I mean, this transition will not happen. I mean, this will take a very long time scale. I mean, in the millisecond time scale, these transitions happen. So how do you simulate, how do you describe, or how do you investigate this kind of a system which where the phenomena happens in the millisecond time scale? So here the system is described various in various model. So one of the method is that utilizing the coarse grain method, because the coarse grain method will allow you to reduce the system to a fewer number of atoms. As you see that the coarse grain method is a reduced model, so that you can run longer time scale simulation for your system. And obviously you need to take into consideration that the action or the function or the chemical reaction should not be reduced, I mean, to a coarse grain model, because then there will be no chemical information, because that is already approximated as a unified atom. So the appropriate part should be described as the coarse grain method, and the other part should remain as it is to capture the essential physics of the system. And then they have constructed this kind of a free energy surfaces. So we already have seen the example of free energy surface, how complicated this can be. So this is the open conformation, this is the closed conformation. Now you see there are three conformation. This is the conformational barrier, and then that is the chemical barrier for the chemical reaction. And the outcome is that after performing the analysis of this system, that enzyme millisecond conformational dynamics do not catalyze the chemical state. So that is an important information or conclusion that is obtained from this kind of a study. Next is that the ribosome. So you see that this is a huge biological complex. The right hand side is the atomistic description. You see that small atoms are there, and the left hand side is the coarse grain description. You see that the balls, or I mean, the these are bigger, larger compared to the this atomistic thing. So it's very difficult if you want to model this and then simulate this system to understand its function. It will be very difficult to do it by using classical MD simulation. So what we did here, I mean, what these people have done here, this atomistic description is reduced to a coarse grain model. This is a coarse grain model, and this is a all atom model, means every chemical atom, I mean, atom is represented by as it is. And in this case, the side chains, as I have already told you, that the basics of the coarse grain method, that the side chains are approximated as a unified atom. So this model is built, this coarse grain model is built from this all atom model. So then, it will allow you, I mean, this coarse graining of this model will allow you to perform MD simulation of this huge system. And you can see that, the movie is not included here, that the motion of different parts of this ribosome. So that is that has become possible by making this coarse graining scheme of the multi-scale approach. So we have come to an end, and what we have tried to learn here today, that how do you describe the chemical reactions in a biological system, because chemical reaction involve breaking and making of chemical bond with electron reorganization, and electrons come into picture means you need to apply quantum mechanics. And also we have gone through the basics of quantum mechanics in a very preliminary detail. I mean, these are very detailed subject, and it's several classes to understand or to go to more depth. So we have seen the basic feature of the quantum mechanics, that it is represented by a wave function, and it has a wave function wave particle duality. So in the QMM scheme, that the hybrid scheme, that is the multi-scale approach, how do we represent both part? So in the QM part, that is computationally very demanding, as we have seen, and the MM part is computationally cheaper. But the problem was that how do you interface the two region in the multi-scale approach? Even in the core scaling approach also, this thing is that that you need to interface the one level of theory to the another level of theory. I mean, that is very important. I mean, that should be very smooth. Otherwise, there will be problems with the computed results. So in the QMM scheme, we have seen various schemes are there to treat the QMM boundary region, and that method can be useful to study chemical reaction in biological system, that is in enzyme, and also to understand the electron proton transport in the complex system like photosystem to respiratory complex, and in there are other many processes. And this coarse grain model also, that is another multi-scale approach, so that will be useful to deal with the ATP synthase that I have shown you at the beginning of today's slide, that you see the swivelling motion of the ATP synthase, which synthesizes the ATP molecule. So this coarse grain, because ATP synthesis is a huge complex and which perform some physical muscle as well as the chemical reaction. So to study this kind of a large biological system, you need to apply this coarse grain scheme so that it will allow you to get more sampling of the conformational region of the ATP synthase, that is a molecular motor, and then you can apply the QMM method to understand the chemical reaction in the ATP synthase. So I mean, these are the book that I suggest that you go through. Obviously, the topics that I have covered in the multi-scale modeling and simulation of biological system is not exhaustive in any way. These are the basic features of all the methods. I mean, if you are interested, that just if you get some of the basic features of the method, then you can read the documentation, or you can follow the tutorials and you know, the suggested literature, then you will be able to understand more and also able to perform this kind of a simulation. So I hope I will try to upload some study material if you are interested, and as well as some papers for your further reference. And so with this, I will end this topic, that's multi-scale modeling and simulation of biological systems. Today, what we have read is a bit advanced level simulation method. So you need to study a little more to get the flavor of this multi-scale method, because these are, you know, I mean, there are various levels of approximations are there. Those need to be taken care very well. Otherwise, I mean, there will be difficulty in describing or investigation any complex system. So with this, I will stop today, and thank you, all the best. So I'll be happy to answer any questions if you have. I hope you have understand the difference between the classical MD simulation, that I think is the quite popular as well as mostly used method for studying biological system. And today what we have studied is the multi-scale model method. So these are a bit more detailed and more computationally more involving. So I mean, I hope you have got the difference between the two kinds of method and where to apply this particular method and for which system. So that is quite important. So any question, I mean, or anything, any clarification you want, you can write in the chat box or you can ask. So I'll be happy to answer. I mean, regarding the QMM method and the closed gain method. So for this multi-scale method, these are very, I mean, important method because Nobel Prize, I think already I have mentioned, was awarded in 2013 for developing this method to the three person, Aria Warshall, Michael Levitt, and Martin Karplas. So what we have seen, I mean, so far that we need classical mechanics, that is the Newton equation of motion, as well as quantum mechanics, actually, to describe the complex system. And that's why this the multi-scale method comes into picture, because that combines the best of both the world. You know, quantum mechanics is very mathematically involved, detailed, and classical mechanics is a bit simpler approximation to the biological system. So you choose one method based on your requirement. I mean, classical method can describe, I mean, many things, or it can provide important insight into the biological system. But for certain kind of a complex biological system, as I have already told you, so you need to resort, or you need to shift to this multi-scale method, that is hybrid QMM method, coarse grain method, and like this. So any clarification or any question if you have, you can ask me. For quantum mechanics, you can read the book by Donald Mercury. I have already, I think, given the reference. I mean, if you want to know a little more, so that is a relatively easier book. I mean, not that mathematically involved, or the mathematics are well explained. So you can go through the books, because you see there are two approximation. One is molecular mechanics, and the other is quantum mechanics. So I have tried to give you the basic flavor of both this method. I mean, obviously, classical method in more detail compared to the quantum method, that is just the basic features on. So I hope you have understand that the difference between these two methods.